ceremony that mirrored their own character. Warm, welcoming, and somewhat wistful. But the next day came the big surprise that nature had been saving for the games. A howling, driving blizzard from out of the Northwest that canceled alpine skiing events for days and threatened to paralyze the games. Somehow, Sarajevo survived. The competition began. Scott Hamilton, small in stature but a giant in his sport, bore the burden of heavy favorite coming into the games. He came through. Scotty won his gold medal at Sarajevo. We were thrilled by the near-perfect ice dancing of Great Britain's Jane Torvill and Christopher Dean. They were followed in England as closely as the Beatles had been in their time. Their story reached its climax with this performance. Skating to Ravel's Bolero, they received 12 perfect marks of 6.0 and had set a standard that would be difficult for any ice dancers to equal in the future. It was impossible to think of political differences when you looked at East Germany's beautiful, charming teenager, Katharina Witt. We met her up close and personal during her dance training. And then we saw the results of the long hours of training and practice when she skated this marvelous performance in the free skating final. Katharina. America's Rosalind Summers knew that her work was cut out for her as she waited to follow Katharina onto the ice. It wouldn't be easy. In fact, it would be impossible. Rosalind gave it her best, and it was very good indeed, as you see. And she did herself and her country proud, getting the only perfect mark of 6 in the women's final. But Katharina won the gold. Together, Katharina and Rosalind provided the Games of Sarajevo with beauty, charm, and the kind of sporting spirit that transcends politics and border guards. Remember Kitty and Peter Carruthers?
Straight line steps. They're conservative, they're with it, they're doing everything nicely. Everything nicely. They have not dropped off the level that they've started with. Lateral twist lift. And now pulls. And their final move, a pair sit spin. Oh, how nice they have done so well. No mistakes.
In the end, they won the silver medal. The Carruthers had exceeded their own expectations. We met the people of Yugoslavia, and we also saw the land, ancient, austere, and beautiful in turn. We saw it up close and personal. Here's the ancient town of Dubrovnik. Some scenes could have taken place in the Middle Ages, before the Turks came to rule Sarajevo for 400 years and more. If man is the erratic factor in a country, men and women also give a nation its face and its personality. In time, the blizzard stopped, and an American named Debbie Armstrong brought the mountain to life with this run in the women's giant slalom.
A few more gates and possibly a medal, and possibly a medal. Her running time on the right. You'll see the time she must beat to take the lead on the left.
She's going to be right in there, Frank.
Debbie Armstrong through the last gates, into the tuck. She's in first place. She has to beat that time.
And then came Kristen Cooper.
Going for the gold. The Americans cheering at the finish line. Here comes Kristen Cooper.
Second
place. We've got a 1-2 thus far. Oh, wow. Debbie Armstrong.
It was a gold and silver medal for the United States. A year before the Lake Placid Olympics, skiing in a World Cup race on the very mountain where the 1980 Olympic competition would take place, Phil Mayer, America's top hope, suffered this heartbreaking accident. He broke his ankle badly. But a year later, on a screwed-together ankle, Phil came back and won a silver medal in the game. At Sarajevo, he was a disappointment until the final day of competition. After a bad start on the World Cup circuit, he and brother Steve both were unimpressive in the giant slalom. But then came the slalom, a race we'll never forget.
10 years on the World Cup circuit. This will be the final.
He's having a good run, Frank. He's going to be good down through here.
Take the lead is on the left from Bouvier. And he got first place. Bill Mayer into first place. And still to come, his brother Steve.
Bill's first thought after crossing the finish line was to radio to his brother at the top of the course to tell him what the course was like, what to watch out for. As Steve came out of the starting gate, he was the only racer left with a realistic chance of beating his identical twin brother. It was a fascinating situation. Steve, the younger brother by a few minutes, had trailed his brother by fractions of seconds nearly all of their competitive lives. To be sure, Steve had been world giant slalom champion, but that was an exception. Now, his final Olympic run was a wild trip down the mountain. He courted disaster all the way, in contrast to Phil's smooth, technically beautiful performance. Look at that. When he was done, he trailed his brother again. But the Mayers led all the rest of the world. They had won the gold and silver medal. What a day for Phil. That night, Scott Hamilton turned over the honor of carrying the flag to him. And earlier in the day, his wife had given birth to Alexander Ryan Mayer. There was glory for the home team, too. Yugoslavia had never won a Winter Olympics medal of any kind until the day that Jure Franko skied himself into the legends of his land by winning a silver medal in the giant slalom. They chanted his name far into the frozen night, engraving it in their minds forever. Jure Franko. Yes, there were somber times and funny ones and flashes of brilliance or hard luck, all flashing back to our minds in quick succession. One moment, one memory, one jump.
I get up and nothing gets me down. You got it tough. I've seen the toughest around. And I know, baby, just how you feel. You got to roll with the punches and get the what's real.
Can there be a simpler American name than Bill Johnson? It was he, unheralded, almost unknown until a month or so before the Games, who became the first American man to win a gold medal on skis in the Olympics. And he did it in the Europeans' own specialty, the downhill.
No American has ever finished higher than fifth in the Olympic downhill. Bill Beck did it in 52, Pete Patterson in 1980.
Frank, you look very good on the top part. You still have to remember that Zurbriggen was outstanding on the bottom, though. Look at him, he's trying to stay in that tuck all the way down. As soon as he gets out of a turn, you're going to see him get right back into it.
That's Zurbriggen's time on the left.
We're going to know right here how he was on the top part. Oh,
he's close.
0.2 seconds behind. That's what he has to make up. Zurbriggen was good on the bottom, though.
Johnson has always been good on the bottom, though, Bob. He can make it up.
Okay, this is going to be very close. Zurbriggen fired a good one at him. But this is where he is great, as you said.
Down through the glass and heading towards the first big bump. Beautiful!
Right back into his tuck, Frank, and now here's where he's really fast. He has a very fast pair of skis, and he knows how to ride them.
Again! Zurbriggen's time will come up on the left. Billy Johnson into the tuck.
It's going to be very, very close down here, Frank.
Can he do it?
Yes, Bill Johnson, the unknown, the underdog, made ski racing history at Sarajevo. The games ended with a lovely closing ceremony. Simple and warm and as well organized as everything had been. An ancient city in a struggling country had taken its place on the roster of those who had welcomed the world sincerely and now sent the athletes home satisfied that whether they had won or lost, they had received their opportunity to once in their lives try to be the best in the world at something.
Happy holidays from Ford and your local Ford dealer.
Holiday greetings from Budweiser. The people who bring you Budweiser wish you and